We believe in a doctrine called dispensationalism. In other words, we believe in dividing verses to the right group of people and right time period. Because if you don't divide verses, then you're going to combine all the verses together and come up with wrong doctrine. A great example is the book of 1 John. Ray Comfort's, one of his favorite epistles and books that he uses, is the book of 1 John in his gospel soul winning. If there's a gospel soul winning that you want to do to make a person doubt his salvation, then 1 John will be your favorite. If you want to get a soul assured of his salvation, then you're going to use the Pauline epistles. 1 John, you got to realize that this book is used by Lordship Salvation, Ray Comfort. We had a few who are influenced by Ray Comfort's false teachings, and they were influenced to use 1 John in their soul winning. And because of that, they gave an improper method of salvation. So that's why dispensationalism is important. We're going to look at 1 John chapter 2. Why is it Ray Comfort's favorite book? Because it's showing what a saved Christian will do. If you're really a saved child of God, then you will do all these things. So if you don't do all these things, these fruits, these works of a saved Christian, then you're not really saved. That's what Ray Comfort teaches. We're going to look at 1 John chapter 2. And notice what the verse says right here. In verse 4, he that saith, I know him. So if you say that you know God and keepeth not his commandments is a what? Liar. And the truth is not in him. Look at verse 9. He that saith, he is in the light. All right, if you say that you're in the light, are you really a saved child of light? No. And hateth his brother is in what? Darkness even until now. So if you don't love your brother as much as you should, then you're actually part of the darkness. Keep reading verse 10. He that loveth his brother abideth in the light, and there is none occasion of stumbling in him. See that this condition of staying in the light is loving the brethren as much as you should. We're going to look at verse 11. But he that hateth his brother is in darkness and walketh in darkness, and knoweth not whither he goeth, because that darkness hath blinded his eyes. Let's keep reading right here. You're going to notice that at chapter 2 and verse 28. And now, little children, abide in him, that when he shall appear, we may have confidence and not be ashamed before him at his coming. If ye know that he is righteous, so if you know that person to be righteous, notice, ye know that everyone that doeth righteousness is born of him. So everyone that doeth righteousness, then you know that he's a saved child of God. That's what the Apostle John is showing. So thus, when you see all these people who are doing these works that a saved Christian would look like he would do, then you would automatically assume, oh, then he must be a saved person. But if there's a saved Christian who don't do these works, then what's going to be the thought? Oh, he is not a saved person. So that's why Ray Comfort will use that tactic to make you people doubt and question your salvation. Let's also read chapter 3. I mean, it's all over the book of 1 John. That's why this is his favorite chapter. Look at verse 7. Little children, let no man deceive you. He that doeth righteousness is what? Righteous, even as he is righteous. So if you do righteous things, then you're considered to be part of the righteous. But look at verse 6. Whosoever abideth in him. So if you are abiding in God, then what happens? Sinneth not. Whosoever sinneth. Okay, have you Christian sinned? If you Christian sinned, hath not seen him, neither known him. Well, that's problematic right there. If you Christian sin, then the Apostle John says, you didn't even know Jesus Christ. You never even seen or know Jesus Christ. That's pretty tough right there. But look at verse 10. In this the children of God are manifest and the children of the devil. Okay, this is really bad right here. In this you can tell who's a saved child of God and who's a child of the devil. Keep reading. Whosoever doeth not righteousness is not of God, neither he that loveth not his brother. If you don't love your brother and sister in Christ, and if you don't do righteousness, then you're a child of the devil. Whoa. Keep reading. Verse 11. For this is the message that ye have heard from the beginning, that we should love one another. But look at verse 14. We know that we have passed from death unto life. You know you're a saved person. You pass from death and you're into eternal life. Why? Because we love the brethren. It's based on that. He that loveth not his brother abideth in death. Whosoever hateth his brother is a murderer. If you don't love your brother as much as you should and you hate him, then God calls you a murderer. And look at this. And ye know that no murderer hath what? Eternal life. You're not considered saved. That's pretty bad right there. So you notice right here that it's all these verses are showing these works of what a saved Christian would do. And if you don't do these works, then you're considered not to be a saved person, which is quite a problem. Now, a lot of the people, they'll use 1 John 2, 1 John 3, and they'll use other verses at the book of 1 John to prove works of a Christian. If they don't see these works as a saved Christian, then they automatically assume it means you're lost. If there are no works of a saved Christian, then you are evidence of being a lost person. So that's why it makes people very fearful and they wonder if they're really saved or lost. Now, there are some people, what they would do is that they would try to make 1 John not a general epistle talking about faith and works. But I'm going to be honest with you. If you look at the book of 1 John, especially they'll use chapter 5. But the problem with this is that if you go to 1 John 5 or any other chapter in the book of 1 John, it does talk about believing a lot. And if you're believing, you're considered to be born of God. Okay, good. But the problem is this, is that he continues on with works. It's impossible to separate faith and works. Faith and works. It's impossible to separate that method in the book of John. But look, if you're a Bible-believing dispensationalist, you can tell what this faith and works method would be. Because here we are in dispensationalism. We know that the Old Testament is faith and works. We know that the church age is faith alone without works. Amen and amen. We have right here, so just to save time, F and W. But then also notice right here, if you know your Bible as a dispensationalist, what is the tribulation salvation method? It's faith and works, isn't it? If you know your Bible, there was a transitional time period in between here, between the church age and the Old Testament. And then as the church gets raptured up, and when they get raptured up right here, we are not going through the tribulation. The tribulation time period, you know, is a program for who? Is it for the church or for Israel? It's for Israel, if you know your Bible. How do you know that, preacher? Go to Revelation chapter 7, 12 tribes of Israel mentioned. Look at Daniel chapter 9, verse 27. It says the last week, Daniel's 70th week, which is tribulation, 7 years, is referring to Israel. It's for Israel, thy people, Daniel. The Old Testament, God's chosen people, was what? Israel. That's why this salvation method you can see similarly. If it's faith and work system that John was writing past the Old Testament, then what other dispensation would it apply to? It would be right here, the tribulation. So we know that the book of 1 John is a tribulation epistle. It is during this time period. Well, how do you know that, preacher? How do you know that? Simple. First of all, look at the chapter 2. Notice that he does talk about the tribulation, and he even mentions about the Antichrist who will come at the tribulation. Verse 18, chapter 2, verse 18. Little children, it is what? The last time. See? Tribulation reference. But keep reading. And as ye have heard, that Antichrist shall come. See that? He's talking about this Antichrist that's going to come out at the tribulation. Even now are there many antichrists, whereby we know that it is what? The last time. He is speaking as a tribulation reference. Not only that, go to the book of Galatians chapter 2. Galatians chapter 2. So we saw at 1 John 2 and Galatians 2, that John's epistle was to tribulation Jews. That's his ministry. His ministry was to the Jewish people. We're going to look at the book of Galatians chapter 2. Galatians chapter 2. Verse 9. And when James, Cephas, and who? John. And these are apostles, you notice, of general epistles. Keep reading. Who seemed to be pillars, perceived the grace that was given unto me. They gave to me and Barnabas the right hands of fellowship, that we, Paul, should go unto who? The heathen, non-Jews, Gentiles. And they, which includes John, unto who? The circumcision, Jews. So notice right here that 1 John 2 and Galatians 2 showed you a heads up that John's writings will have tribulation application and Jewish application. So there's your simple answer, is that these verses are, when it talks about faith and works, is referring to tribulation Jews. Now there's a group of heretics called hyper-dispensationalists. So we don't end it right here, folks. We also mention right here, even though it's tribulation Jews, there's another application. We also believe the book of 1 John can apply to Christians. You might say, why do you believe the book of 1 John can apply to Christians? Because there are references in there that shows it can refer to Christians. We're going to look at the book of 1 John chapter 5. 1 John chapter 5. And look at verse 13. 1 John chapter 5 and verse 13. We'll start with verse 11 actually. Verse 11. And this is the record that God hath given to us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He that hath the Son hath life, and he that hath not the Son of God hath not life. These things have I written unto you, that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that ye have eternal life, and that ye may believe on the name of the Son of God. Have you all believed on the name of the Son of God for your salvation? Amen. Then that means this verse says you have eternal life. See that? Here's another verse. Look at 1 John chapter 2. This is a great verse that I use. Look at 1 John chapter 2, and we will read verse 1. My little children, these things write I unto you, that ye sin not. And if any man sin, we have a what? An advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And he is a propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. Can Christians claim that? Absolutely. So you can see that verse doctrinally applies to us. Not only that, look at the book of 1 John chapter 3, 1 John chapter 3, and look at verse 9. 1 John chapter 3 and verse 9. So we saw chapter 2 and chapter 3 proving that these are referring to Christians. Look at 1 John chapter 3 verse 9. Whosoever is born of God, are you born of God? Amen. Amen. Look at this. Doth not commit sin. You know why you cannot commit sin? Look at this, for his seed remaineth in him, and he cannot sin because he is born of God. Because of the spiritual seed in you. So because of that spiritual nature in you, who's the real you? Who's the one born of God? Who's the real you? That spiritual nature, right? So because God doesn't look at your fleshy nature, but rather your spiritual nature, see, no matter how many sins you commit in this body, God says you're not sinning. Why? Because you, who's not sinning, is the spiritual nature within you. That's a very great verse for eternal security. That's why we're not going to look over there, but 1 John chapter 1, it talks about confessing sins and having them washed away by the blood of Jesus. This thing is mutilated by hyper-dispensationalists because they don't believe that a Christian has to confess his sins. They don't believe in that for fellowship. So that's why they'll chop off chapter 1. But no, we claim it because we see verses in chapter 2 and chapter 3 that can apply to Christians. So That's why we're Bible-believing dispensationalists, believing that there is a double application. One, for tribulation Jews. Second, for Christians. Some people might say, no, that's just weird. That's just strange. That's just messed up. You cannot believe that a chapter or a verse can split and divide to different time periods. What are you talking about? Go to Isaiah chapter 61. Isaiah. What are you talking about? Of course, a verse can split to two different time periods. One verse, even one verse, can split to two different time periods. Isaiah chapter 61. Now, I'm not going to read the passage for time's sake, but those of you who are familiar with dispensationalism in my other teachings, Isaiah chapter 61, verses 1 through 2, and then you just compare that, if you want to do homework, compare that with the book of Luke chapter 4, where Jesus was reading this passage from Isaiah 61. You know what you're going to find out? Is that you're going to find out that this passage, verse 2, one was split to the first advent of Jesus Christ, and the second half of verse 2 was split to the second advent. That's why in Luke chapter 4, Jesus Christ, when he was reading Isaiah 61, 1 through 2, he divided and stopped in the middle of verse 2, believing that that part was applying to his time period, whereas the rest of the verse would apply to a future time period. The Bible is built with that kind of system, you got to understand. Yes, you can have two different time periods at the book of 1 John. That is very possible, absolutely possible. Why would John write like that? You know why John would write like that? It is very simple if you understand the author. His ministry was to Jews, correct? His ministry was to Jews, and he was talking to them about the tribulation. But where did he learn that doctrine from? It was in Jesus' ministry before he died on the cross. New Testament Christian salvation before that. Jesus, for example, if you read Matthew 24, Matthew 5, I mean, read the majority of the preaching of Jesus. Majority was a tribulation Jewish preaching, you'll notice, about end times. Even at Berkeley, when I attended school there, the scholars realized a lot of it was apocalyptic reference, they admitted, what Jesus preached about. But guess what? John was trained under that. That's why he taught a lot of tribulation Jewish things. But not only that, you got to realize this. Was John the apostle only ministering to Jews, or did he include some Gentiles? If you read the life and story of John, I mean, look at Revelation, for example, as well. He was ministering to churches that were Gentiles as well. That's why he has a double teaching, double application in his teaching, because he has one ministering to tribulation Jews for the most part, but then there are some he can't deny for Gentile Christians, because he ministered to those people too. And for Gentile Christian doctrine, you got to realize this. Who was the foundation and taught that? It was the Apostle Paul. You read Galatians 2, right? Paul said, my ministry was to the Gentiles. That was Paul's ministry. And you got to realize John's ministry outlived Paul. So what was his knowledge? You see that? So his knowledge was New Testament Christianity under Paul, and then also the tribulation Jewish reference under Jesus Christ. See that? So because of that, that explains his writings would have a double application. One to tribulation Jews, the other part to Christians. We will never know, trust me, you will never know the mind of the Bible authors such as Isaiah, Daniel, John, and even Paul himself. You want to know everything of what they were thinking when they were writing. You know why? Because the Bible says holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. That's why. Because it's God's words, not their words. God knew what he was thinking, not man. And you know what God knew? It's obvious. Now we know what God was trying to do. God was showing a tribulation Jewish application, because that's what their system will be in the future. And he also gave verses because he knew what the Christian church age would have to practice as well. Dispensationalism is absolutely important to believe in dividing verses, chapters, and double application. That is the rule of dispensationalism. Because God, the author, is writing your Bible, and he is not restricted by time. You got to understand. Because he is not restricted by time, he's not going to give a clean reference where it says, this is for this time period, that is for that time period. He's not going to do it like that.